when we do a concert, my feeling is that we really are there praising almighty rock and roll because of all that it makes possible. And I see myself more as an evangelical preacher, just telling everybody, stand up and praise, you know, holy rock and roll and the power it gives us all.
First of all, size does count.
You wanted the best, and you got the best. The hottest band in the world. Yeah!
Here they are, the biggest band in the world, before we were anybody.
We had about 200,000 people there who came to see just us.
It was surreal, like you just landed on Planet Kiss.
It was known as Kisteria. We were the front page of the newspaper every day.
We tried desperately to put on a brave face, in full makeup, of course.
This is the story of Kiss, and it's a long one and a big one. We've always prided ourselves in keeping that in our little treasure trove until we felt it was time to release it.
The Kiss Vault is filled with literally hundreds and hundreds of hours backstage.
Look, it's rock and roll!
Concert tours nobody's seen, in the studio, all kinds of stuff people have never seen before.
KISSology 2 picks up where KISSology 1 left off.
Well, you're gonna see the beginnings of 1978 with Ace and Peter.
One of the great scenes in there is the first show that Kiss did without makeup in Portugal. There's the famous Sydney concert.
Hello, Australia, this is Gene Simmons of Kiss.
Which was our first trip to Australia.
All right, Sydney!
Which arguably matched the Beatles.
Even though people watching KISSology 2 are going to be seeing Kiss Meets the Phantom, interviews with Tom Snyder.
Where we had to hold our breath and hope that Ace would make it through the show in one piece, and he wound up stealing the show.
What was going on in the background were two out of the four guys trying to figure out whether they wanted to continue in Kiss or go their separate ways and try solo careers.
By 1978, we had scaled the height. Kiss became synonymous with being the hottest and biggest band in America, arguably the world. So there we were at the pinnacle of our success. And ironically, one of the things that came along was a movie. We're going to make a Kiss movie. The fact that none of us in the band had a clue what acting was immaterial.
He's the one, all right. Almost tore my arm off.
Gene's clean.
A pussycat. Almost.
Hi, Curly.
The fact that none of us understood what the script was or really memorized it also was immaterial. We were told that we were going to make a cross between A Hard Day's Night and Star Wars.
Star Child!
No gratitude need be voiced. Your mind speaks to us.
You're looking for someone. But it's not Kiss.
I remember the day that I finally saw Kiss Meets the Phantom of the Park, and I saw the box levitating.
With the strings,
yeah.
Of course.
What are those called? Those little icons? The talisman.
Talisman.
I'd heard about your talisman, but I didn't think they really existed. What's that humming noise?
It's a cosmic force field which protects our talisman.
Pretty mystical.
Without them, no powers.
Interestingly, when we were filming, the band wasn't talking to each other.
By the middle of Kiss Meets the Phantom, it was very clear how far apart we were. At the end of the day, some of the guys would leave early.
Ace! Ace might decide that his day of shooting was over and he might leave. In some scenes, there's actually a stunt double who is actually in the scenes in his place. There's another scene of us on stage where there's an old gentleman in cat makeup playing the drums, and it's not Peter.
We're just ordinary human beings.
Not quite ordinary.
We were in the fight scenes. When needed, there were the stunt doubles, but there was actually the scene where we fight our evil selves. So that was us and our stunt doubles.
Are you ready for the real Kiss?
We never had a clue what this movie was about.
Armageddon is coming to this park tonight.
We don't work with a second act, Devereaux. Besides, Armageddon is a lame group.
I still don't understand why the Phantom turns old at the end and turns around in the chair. It's a mystery.
He created Kiss to destroy Kiss, and he lost.
The interesting thing for people watching Kiss Meets the Phantom on KISSology Volume 2 is that many people have a memory of it being much greater and exciting and grander than it actually was.
This is ridiculous.
And here's everybody's chance to see it for what it really is.
True genius.
Yep. But misdirected.
The band, known as Kiss worldwide, had a major shift in personnel.
Peter was going to leave.
Was not good in the house of Kiss.
Forever, we say goodnight and go home.
You wanted the best, you got the best. Kiss. KISSology Volume 2, 1978 to 1991. The second installment of the ultimate live Kiss DVD collection, a monster three-disc set. And for the first time on DVD, Kiss in Attack of the Phantoms.
We've got to get out of here.
You gotta lose your mind in Detroit. Rocks.
KISSology Volume 2 in stores Tuesday, August 14th.
In our own way, deeply loved this thing we had created together called Kiss. Except what was happening was each of us wanted to express themselves a little more.
It was a very interesting time. It was really the first glimpse of major trouble up ahead.
By 1978, there was some inner turmoil within the band. All was not good in the house of Kiss. Ace and Peter, who were equally as important with Paul and myself in starting the band and carrying the weight, started to have misgivings, started to have second thoughts about continuing with the band.
We wanted people to see us as four individuals who had to be together in a band. That was no longer the case, and it became more difficult with time to keep the truth from getting out, and it also made it much less enjoyable because of the tension. Shandy was a video that was filmed for a song on Unmasked. That was Peter's last video.
I just can't pretend no more. I keep running out of lies.
Peter was already out of the band, and we needed to shoot one more video, so we went in and shot this pretty cheesy video.
Every time I find the
knowing full well that at the end of it, Peter was going to leave. So it was a bit bittersweet.
And I know you can tell.
the end of the video, we all went into the dressing room, took off our makeup, and he literally took his makeup case and went home. Looking for a drummer to replace Peter, the process was someone would send a resume and a photo, and then the ones who seemed the most possible as a prospective replacement would come and play with us in rehearsal.
What's the name of the new drummer?
I think his name is I remember. His name is Eric Carr, and he's incredible.
Eric was this sweet little guy who came in with hair that was big enough that it barely made it through the door.
Eric was so good. I mean, for the first week, though, he did have to wear diapers.
Got behind that drum kit and played like an octopus. Really played precisely and with tremendous passion.
I was really quite positive about the whole thing, and I was really excited.
Eric was the reason that we could go forward. The shows in Australia so remarkable, of which Sydney is one of them, was that we had been told ahead of time that we were huge in Australia. Nothing could have prepared us for how big we really were.
Oh, it's closing time again. You know it'll always win. Closing time again. You know it's the only thing that keeps us together.
We literally had to take the floor of a hotel and have no one else there, have the elevators guarded, have all the curtains closed. People were camping outside 24/7. If we wanted to leave the hotel, we literally had to lay on the bottom of a car and be taken out in a decoy car.
The promoter was thrilled because we were doing multiple shows in the stadium. Sold out. We were helicoptered into a lot of them. We were getting headlines every day. It was coined as Kisteria. It really was like being a kid in a candy store. Anything and everything that would come out of your mouth in terms of a I want would just happen.
It was amazing. It was really eye-opening for us because it took everything that we had dreamed of to a height that we didn't even know could exist. We had about 200,000 people there who came to see just us. It wasn't a rock festival, it was KISS.
It was surreal, like you just landed on planet KISS.
Although we didn't realize it, this was the end of the first era of Kiss in makeup.
As many as one in 166 children are diagnosed.
That's more than 68 a day.
That's almost 1.5 million people in the U.S. alone.
And more than type 1 diabetes, childhood cancer, and cystic fibrosis combined.
Making it the fastest growing developmental disability in the United States.
It often goes undiagnosed.
No one knows where it comes from.
And today, there is no cure. Help us put an end to autism.
Go to rockautism.vh1classic.com now to find out how you can get involved.
KISSology 2 contains the famous concert we did, the last concert we did in makeup, which was Maracanã in Brazil, the largest stadium in the world.
The size of it defies description. Large doesn't mean what it sounds like. Take almost any stadium and make it three or four times bigger.
We had about 200,000 people there who came to see just us. It wasn't a rock festival, it was Kiss.
Checked into our hotels, we were literally trapped there. When we finally went to the concert, we went with a military brigade, soldiers, not policemen, with machine guns, in armored personnel carriers with tank tracks in back of us and in front of us. This was unlike anything we'd ever seen before. We'd had police escorts, but never the military. This made everything else look like kid stuff.
There, we went out very much knowing that everybody was there to see us, had been waiting years to see us, and we were going to make damn sure that if nothing else, they got a real sense of the passion and intensity that is Kiss.
Look back on it, and when the lights would dim, it was a hot summer night, and the spotlights were way down. It looked like a half a mile down, surrounded by people like locusts. And when they'd start jumping up and down to the music, it looked like a locust plague in the Old Testament. And the spotlights would hit us on stage over the heads of the people, and there were so many people and so much heat there, you literally saw smoke coming off everybody. It was surreal, like you just landed on planet Kiss. I remember us rehearsing behind the stadium before we went on. And when you know that there's 200,000 people waiting to see you, it doesn't leave your thought. We went out there more with bravado and adrenaline than rehearsal. Although we didn't realize it, this was the end of the first era of Kiss in makeup. We went out with a bang. That was the last time that Kiss wore makeup. Kiss in makeup had run its course. It was at that point that we were either going to take off the makeup and prove ourselves to be a band worthy of surviving, or it was time to pack it in. Point after Ace Frehley and Peter Criss left the band, when the band released an album we were really proud of called Creatures of the Night that didn't see initial commercial success, and we had two new members, Eric Carr and Vinnie Vincent, we went out and played in front of the largest audience we'd ever played to date as if it was a brand new band. In a very real way, it showed us that no one person, maybe not even any two people, are going to determine who and what Kiss is. When we decided to take the makeup off, what became clear to us was that we were starting to lose the essence of what we were in the beginning. We were four guys who came up with the initial characters. Although each one of us may have played a more significant part in coming up with our individual identity, the four of us were in there, making that happen. You can look at a picture of Kiss anywhere in the world and you know who it is. When we started to lose members, it became a menagerie. It became replacing an iconic member of a band with something that was created in a much more premeditative fashion. You know, all of a sudden we were on the verge of having Giraffe Man in the band or Ant Boy. It got silly. Kiss in makeup had run its course. It was at that point that we were either going to take off the makeup and prove ourselves to be a band worthy of surviving, or it was time to pack it in.
This is a really big moment. After 10 years together, exclusively here on MTV this evening, we are going to see Kiss without their makeup for the very first time.
It was a perfect tie-in for us to unmask on MTV. That they saw as something that was newsworthy and worthy to be carried on this very, very hot video channel, which was unlike anything else at that time.
Vinnie Vincent, lead guitarist and co-writer of many of the songs on the current Kiss album. Eric Carr, drummer, has been with the band since 1979, and Kiss is the very first band that Eric has ever been with. Paul Stanley, rhythm guitarist and lead vocalist. Paul is a co-founder of the group. Gene Simmons, bass, also co-founder of Kiss. He is the fire-breathing, blood-spitting monster of Kiss. Welcome, you guys. This is amazing.
Strangely,
the unmasking was only of two original members. So although it carried a lot of clout and people were watching it, it was diluted by the fact that this was not the original band.
Very first time out. How does it feel now without makeup?
I feel fine about it. No, I'm fine. It feels good. We've always been close to our fans, and I think it's time for them to sort of know us a little bit more. It feels very, very comfortable.
Nothing really changes because we only know one way to perform. You know, the makeup never had anything to do with the bombs or the doing splits or whatever we were doing on stage comes from us.
Kiss is still Kiss. Same sort of energy and drive and commitment to doing everything short of killing ourselves to give people the best show in the world.
Unmasking, taking the makeup off, finally telling everybody Kiss isn't just makeup and bombs and everything you think it is. Kiss is songs, Kiss is depth, Kiss is the four people under the makeup and the platform heels. Unmasking in front of MTV affected different people in different ways. We decided that we would continue without makeup. We had decided to commit to it completely.
Playing on stage in Lisbon, Portugal, without the makeup is a pivotal point. I remember being up on stage and almost feeling, what's wrong with this picture? It's almost like it was sound check, but here's an audience there. The band's heart and passion was in the right place. But it was very, very odd to look at everybody and not see anybody look any different than they did 2 hours before. There was an audience that was pretty baffled too, because the event was promoted as Kiss with makeup because the promoter had bought the idea of the concert and didn't realize that at that point we were going to be unmasked. So the posters had us in makeup. And I remember the sense that when we were on stage playing the first few songs, there was clearly a sense in part of the audience, who are these guys? What is this? Until it really became clear, it's Kiss without makeup.
For me, the big point of commitment to the new version of Kiss was doing the photo session for the cover of Lick It Up.
We decided that the makeup should come off, and not surprisingly, Lick It Up, the next album, sold 5 times what Creatures sold, and it was just proof that people had begun to listen with their eyes instead of their ears, because Creatures was arguably a better album. Thing that goes along with most bands lasting for a long period of time is there is an inevitable personnel change.
Here's a little song for everybody out there.
Bruce joined the band for the Animalize tour and stayed with us right through to the reunion. Crazy Night was really his official introduction as a member of the band. We always did our best under any circumstances to stay true to who we were and to put forward what we believed Kiss to be. Didn't always succeed.
All right, Philadelphia!
We had decided to basically reinvent ourselves, and then we had to figure out what was KISS going to be like on stage.
You were the best, and you got the best!
Because the outfits and the sort of the darker vision of KISS was something that was a little easier to define.
The hottest band in the world!
Here we were, bigger than life, filling out all the arenas. What could be bigger than the past?
Kill!
Let's kick it up a notch. Let's kick it up quite a bit. We literally built a KISS sign that stood, could have been 25 feet or more high, that did everything within the logo. It's like nothing anybody had ever seen. About KISS, no matter how much money we made, we never penny pinched in putting the money back into the show. Ourselves in going back out on stage, back out on tour, and making sure that at the end of the night people said, yeah, that was the best show I ever saw. Bill and Ted's Excellent Adventure was a movie that came out, and we were approached by the film company to do a song for it, the ending song. We decided on doing God Gave Rock and Roll to You, KISS style.
Eric Carr was in a very advanced stage of heart cancer. He was still recovering from heart surgery. He had been sutured up. It meant the world to him to come out and be a part of this video. And I remember marveling that he wanted to shoot his performance over and over and over again to get a great version that would capture his fire and his intensity.
Flew out, though he was very ill, and played his heart out in that video. When you look back on God Gave Rock and Roll the video today, you can't tell he's ill at all. He must have been in pain, and he played his heart out. God Gave Rock and Roll to You doesn't just stand out as a terrific song, it really is a testament to Eric Carr. God gave rock and roll to you. Not just a great drummer, just a really special human being. Save rock and roll for everyone. Save rock and roll. Anything that has the name KISS on it is something we take enormous pride in.
I think we went on stage with a really newfound commitment.
Come on, people! Stay with us! I wanna rock and roll.
I think the coolest thing about the Hot in the Shade tour was that we were clearly proud of who we were and who we had been in the past. We embraced the early songs. We had this great body of work to choose from. And I think we went on stage with a really newfound commitment. We had Leon, which was the name we had for our Sphinx, Leon Sphinx. And we came through the mouth in typical Grand KISS fashion with these lasers shining. The mouth would open and we would come out. I think we were finally really focused on the legacy of KISS and doing a show that showcased every song from the very beginning up until 88, 89. It was the longest show we ever did. It was grueling. Sometimes it was 25, 26 songs. Then we would proceed to kick ass for a good two and a half hours of nonstop, memorable KISS classics. I think it was by far the best tour of ours at that point since the early 70s. It really was a band that was on fire. KISS, as I see it, has always been a wake-up call to audiences of what is possible and what they're owed. I think what we've always tried to do on stage is give bang for buck in every way possible. When you pay a high ticket price, you should know where that money's going. You should see it, you should feel it, you should hear it. So KISS has been the experience for us that we never got.
We've been enormously fortunate and blessed to have been a part of this thing that we all love called KISS.
What makes KISSology 2 a must-own is what we're doing, in essence, is going into our vault and getting all the material, all the videos, all the nuggets that can't be had any other place. Whenever a TV show wants to do a special on KISS, they have to come to us. We have all the footage from the very early days of playing clubs up until this past tour. So KISSology 2 picks up in 1978 and goes through 1991, just running the gamut of personnel changes, all kinds of behind-the-scenes moments. It's heavy stuff. It's the continuation. In a sense, it's the encyclopedia of KISS.
We'd have camera crews following us around. We'd start cataloging things, demos and old things, before anything happened, before there were videos, before MTV. We just cataloged ourselves because we couldn't believe what was happening. In retrospect, watching back the stuff, it was very easy.
The beauty of doing the commentary for KISSology has been there's a tremendous emotional connection we have to it. It brings back tremendous memories. And not only can we be specific in detail, but more importantly, we can remember what we were feeling and what we're feeling today and watching it.
We didn't have a script. The commentary was just sort of stream of consciousness. Here's what we remember, here's what happened, here's our slice of life on that day.
What we've always tried to be as KISS, we've wanted to be the band we never saw. And in putting packages together, we've always tried to make the packages the kind that we had hoped to get when we went to buy albums or now DVDs of other bands. In doing that, we'll have the special bonuses, whether it's an extra disc with concerts that differ from package to package. For us, it should be a multi-leveled experience and something that most other bands wouldn't even think of doing. But we're not only KISS, we're fans of KISS.